This is our second industry briefing. We had the Honorable Carver just last week speaking on financial services matters. It's very good to see so many of you here this morning. The aim of these briefings is to provide an overview of your sector, but from the policymakers. So our idea behind these briefings is to give you better access to those people who are responsible for developing the environment within which your business operates. And I know you like that, so we're going to try to do more of that so you can find out, A, what's going on, what's going to impact my business, my sector, my industry, and B, maybe I can give some feedback to those people who are responsible for that environment, and hopefully it all works out then you get a chance to participate. I'm not going to say too much. I did want to address a rumor that I was trying to change the Chamber Constitution to be president for life. In fact, the truth is I've been trying to do it for 10 years. I think 10 years is just about enough paperwork. The tourism sector is one of our most important sectors and a key part of the economy. And there's a lot going on right now, and it's one of the reasons we're having this session this morning. It's very exciting right now. Historical numbers as far as arrivals and so on. And we believe the economy is doing very well. Certainly our construction roundtable, which was held about 4 weeks ago, suggested that contractors are gearing up to do a lot over the next 12 to 18 months, including a lot of hiring and so on. So I'm very optimistic and I'm hopeful that this is the same situation with respect to tourism. I do want to mention before I introduce the minister that we will be having a tourism roundtable session where we will invite members like you to come in and sit with us. And that session is open so we can discuss your industry. It's a free open session. And the idea behind it is that you can talk about what's happening in your sector and also give us some input on what you'd like to see change in your sector as far as the policy environment is concerned. And then our job, Chamber's job, is to advocate for changes to that policy environment so that your sector can get what it needs. Because we want you to thrive and we want you to do well. When we have those sessions, we are going to also be working with CETA. I know CETA members are here. The president's here. Welcome. We have the president here as well as the executive director. And I think maybe some members of the executive committee will be working very closely with the Tourism Association to organize that strategy session and have those discussions on where we think our industry should be going. Hopefully that can then feed into what you already know is occurring, which is I know the government has been working on a tourism plan, which is a more longer term plan, and this is a great opportunity for you to put your input directly into that. I know he doesn't really need an introduction, but I will give it sort of an introduction. The Deputy Premier and Minister District Administration, Tourism and Transport. Mr. Moses Kirkconnell is here this morning. He was first elected in 2005. He was re-elected in 2017. He's elected mayor. He's also a nice guy. I'm not going to talk about his Paul Harris Scholarship and all the other achievements that he has obviously secured over the last X number of years. But I will ask you to please welcome him very warmly to the podium.
It's always good to say nice things about the person who's going to speak after you, President Paul. When I walked in this morning, quite a few people looked around and wondered if I'd left anybody in the government building. But the team that we brought with us this morning, I'm going to recognize them a little bit out of order protocol. But because I wanted you to see the importance that we place on giving information this morning. So, Chief Officer Strand Bodden, Councilor David White, Acting Director Sonisha Richards, Sandra Morris has Cameron Ann. Tom Ludington is the New York United States representative. And sample, we came today as a group representing what we believe is an extremely important industry. And I want to thank President Paul and the members of the chamber for inviting us here today. And hopefully if we do a good enough job, they'll invite us back at some point. In remarks today, I want to share kind of in order. I want to start with talking about the results that we've had last year, look at what we think is going to happen and what we're doing this year, share some of the highlights and the work that will continue, and then the department itself is going to come. And what I thought would be very interesting that a lot of people don't get to see is some of the ads that we do in core marketing. Some of the questions that we get, as an example, are, I was in Raleigh, North Carolina, I didn't see Cayman on TV. So you'll see some of the answers, and certainly were more than available in Q&A to let you understand how some of these marketing efforts work. With tourism being the second pillar of our economy, the industry is shouldering tremendous responsibility. Its performance is vital to this country's ongoing success and well-being. The arrivals of 2017, cruise and stay over together was the best. A 2.3% increase over the previous year, 2.1 million visitors to the Cayman Islands. 418,403 came as stay over visitors. That was an increase of 8.5% over the previous year. And 1.7 million arrived by sea, representing a 1% increase over the previous year. But I'll put a note here and say that if we hadn't had the disasters in the Eastern Caribbean, the two Category 5 hurricanes, our cruise arrivals would actually have been down about 1%. So I think that's very important to note. The air arrivals in 2018 is off to an extremely good start, record-breaking months, the first three, and we, for the first quarter, come out with a 20% increase over last year, which is 22,900 more visitors in the first 3 months of this year. The other positioning that we have, which is extremely important and sometimes misses people's watch, is what is the average daily rate of our destination? And the average daily rate of this destination is the highest in the region. So that says two things to you. We're increasing tourists, and they're paying more to come here. Those are the kind of good business people here, very good business people. I'm sure you'll support that. That's the way you like the graph to run. The accommodation sector was $381.25 average daily rate, which was up 6.9% over the previous quarter. From the region, when you look at how we're performing, there's only two islands, and we don't look at their average daily rate, but I would tell you they're much less than ours. The Cuba phenom continues to drive the region, 11.9% increase, and St. Lucia, with Prime Minister Chastanet driving force, is at 11%. But we were at 8.5% with the high daily rate. Very, very good showing for us. So hats off to the industry. The other interesting part when you look at arrivals and you look at the tourism sector is to look at what the actual spend is and the total spend. Because that is really our export. And we're not a country that has bananas, gold, or silver that we put on a ship or a plane and send to another jurisdiction. And all of a sudden, somebody puts in a statistic that we exported $1 billion worth of gold. That's not us. We bring the market to us, which is tourism. And the tourist that we see walking on the street is our export that's actually arrived on our island. Last year, combined between cruise and stayover was $800 million US spent. And what that means is including the tax, and it was a spend without any kind of multiplier attached to it. So if you're going to throw a 5 or 8% multiplier on there, I think it's quite easy to see that we're in the billions of dollars, the value of our tourism is, our economy, and the importance that it is to each one of the businesses. As we move into looking at what we're going to do, I think it's easy for us to say and understand that there's really not a magic formula that you can go and pick off a shelf and say, this is what Cayman is going to do, this is what Little Cayman is going to do, this is what Cayman Rack's going to do, this is what Cuba's going to do, this is what St. Lucia's going to do. There's no one size fits all solution. So that's why each year in tourism is a unique proposition. The strength of our economy has been shown. It's a positive contributor to the industry. Unprecedented growth as a result of careful planning, hard work between, I want to say this a couple of times, between government and the private sector, working hand in hand in the same room, CCIPA. Thank you very much, ladies, for all the partnering and hard work you do this. And thank the chamber members, because I can look out and see all the members that partner with us. But we can't do this by ourselves. The government will be absolutely flat if we don't have participation and involvement in the private sector. So, simply said, we view our job is to work with the private sector and create the environment for success. If we do that together, I think it shows what is taking place now. The dividends of working in the same direction for the same goal. The strength of the economy is also showing positive impact on investors. Driving here this morning across two sites, and then another one on South Church Street that are tourism related, coming out of the ground. Just take a look what that looked like in a year or two. I'm happy to report to you that Margaritaville has another 100 rooms to be opened in the next 30 days. That'll finish up their 300 plus. Grand Hyatt has announced 357 rooms. Locale, 42. NCB, which is one of the ones coming underground, approximately 90. You'll find the brand of that pretty interesting. St. James, 40. Between rooms and villas, and 250. Anybody's been to the Beach Bay lately to see the work being done there, that they're actually excavating now. Dark five star, as we talked about, we would estimate 250, including the villas, and a very special project. And of course, the quarantine is here with 200 rooms coming out of Health City, unless you increase that soon as they're talking. Still 200. So that is approximately 1,289 rooms. If you look at that is what will come online in the next two or three years that we can see coming out of the ground. It shows what will happen to our room stock. Our room stock today is 6,196 rooms. That means 5,821 Grand Cayman, 238 Cayman Brac, and 137 respectively. So based on where we are and what we can see coming out of the ground and happening, we'll have a 20% increase in our room stock in the next 2.5 years. I think that's pretty exciting to look forward from a business standpoint of what are they going to need, what are the opportunities, where you are today, incremental growth for the next 3 years that you see happening right in front of you. Last year's record-breaking arrivals raised the bar and challenges that stakeholders and the tourism department and the ministry and the overall industry to become more innovative and strategic in our view of what we have to do to compete in the international arena. Locally, the challenge find ways to achieve balanced growth so that every district in Grand Cayman, as well as the sister islands, can benefit from the economic opportunity that tourism brings to each one recently signed an MOU with Airbnb to establish a framework for cooperation to further diversify the offerings within our accommodation sector. So the excitement is, we just talked about the bricks and mortar we see coming out. We are now looking at what is the number of local homes and rooms that can actually come online to see what lift is going to be demanded. Forging strong alliances with strategic partners is critical to driving growth within the tourism industry, and in this case creates a win-win-win for the host, the traveler, and the country. This partnership is also an opportunity for visitors to experience the real Cayman as they interact with local citizens and discover the spirit of Cayman for which you're known. And if you just think back, for all of us that grew up here, think of when tourists used to come. They would come the same time every year. They'd come and visit your mother or father, they'd come to church, or they'd come to some activity they had, and they knew you, and you knew them. This is a full circle of getting them back in our communities to interact with us. And I guarantee we have a 50%+ repeat guest. And if you take that segment out and say, the ones that come with vacation rental by owner or Airbnb and stay in the community, what's their return going to be like? I guarantee it's going to be a lot higher than 50%+. We visited Harvey Stevens' place out in about 10 minutes a day. I don't know how many of you have been there. You get a chance to drive by. You can certainly see yourself staying there for a couple days and enjoying it. And that's representative of all the other properties that are available. As a destination, we put a lot of effort in recent years in developing core industry sectors such as weddings, honeymoons, strengthening our dive and cruise tourism sectors, and transitioning our business models to include couples and multi-generational couples. So I ask this question to ask yourself. When you've been out recently, have you seen a grandfather, his son, granddaughter? I recently saw, when I had dinner with Lucas, two different multi-generation families around. Think about it the next time you see them in the community. And think about the transition that the Department of Tourism and the marketing and PR efforts had to go through. They saw an opportunity of a higher spend grouping with grandparents, parents, and children wanting to spend quality time and make memories together in a very special place. But they had to make sure that they knew about and how are they going to attract them, and which market did they advertise to, and how much money did it take them to come here. So that's the zip code you need that has that kind of spend of income. So again, it's when you see an opportunity in the market, it's having the expertise and the ability to go after it and capture it. Because bringing multi-generational families, the thought of making that happen for this season didn't happen last season. It happened 3 or 4 seasons ago. So that's the kind of initiatives you see coming out. Additionally, our business model is working to flatten out the seasonal peaks and valleys, which will enable businesses to benefit from a steady stream of yearly income rather than seasonal that we now experience. It'll take a little while, but as we open different core markets, we'll see how it changes. We are doing very well, simply put. We want to continue to do very well. So to assist with managing the way forward, the ministry, through the Department of Tourism, commissioned the development of a national tourism plan to ensure that the tourism industry continues to grow in a way that is socially, commercially, and environmentally viable for this country. The National Tourism Plan covers a 5-year period between 2018 and 2022 and is intended to provide a framework for piloting growth and development in the tourism sector while conserving natural resources and highlighting our culture. Last month, ministry visited every district. I'm very proud of that. I think I'm the only minister recently. though we are a small island nation, each district has different demands and different needs. And I will tell you some of the biggest entrepreneurs were in East End. And their need was completely different than somebody from Georgetown that wanted to make sure courses were going to be available for the skill set that they wanted or get reskilled and where would that happen. So it has been a tremendous experience of growing our knowledge from ministry and Department of Tourism and how we go forward in this plan. So I think we're off to an extremely good start. Notwithstanding the accomplishments of 2017, the ministry remains energized by last year's success, and we have to be more determined than ever to ensure GS targets growth are achieved and exceeded. The new properties, global brands, and the pipeline will help us finish line by adding interest and diversity to our product base. And I always say that if you can find $300 million, build something, you also have the wherewithal to understand how you're going to pay for that and what your marketing plan is going to be. But our obligation and our duty as the Ministry, the Department of Tourism, and the government is to partner with those investors to understand how we work together to get the maximum benefit for the Cayman Islands themselves. And we have excellent stakeholders. Excellent. Not just because of them. As they open their doors, our ongoing efforts to increase market share will be boosted by the ability to reach a wider cross-section of brand loyal travelers, as well as providing support to ensure there is something that interests visitors throughout the year. Our marketing and promotion spend is being used to connect with millennials by bringing innovative out-of-the-box campaigns to the market, and by doing so, we are aiming to attract the right mix. First time returning guests yielding a return on investment many times greater than the original state. So we talked a little bit about the benefit to Caymanians. And this, I say to you today, is business people in this country. The most important thing you can do is engage with the young people of this country and give them and show them opportunity. And I see Parker there, and I know how much he does for young people. Quite a few of you here, and I know that each one of you reach out. What we're doing at the ministry level and the department is we're 4 years into hospitality school. This is our vocational school that we fund, that we take all of the roadblocks out, scholarships, help, mentoring, whatever we can do to make them successful. So I'm happy to tell you that 100 young people have graduated and gone into the workforce. And sometimes we do presentations and people say, 100 people in 4 years. Well, guess what? If we hadn't started, we wouldn't have any today. So we've made a start. This year has the most enrolled. It's a very strong commitment from government to fund it and give it what it needs. And I know you here today make that same commitment. And I tell them, when they come out and they're looking for jobs, go look for some of the business people that have started the exact same way you have and worked their way up, and they're happy to bring you on. So I say that if you have ideas or if you want to give some time to some of the classes there, to talk, please let us know, and we're happy to let you be more and more involved. And I thank you for all that you do now for them. So, that's where we are. We also have scholarships to Johnson & Wales, which is a very special program for us because Johnson & Wales puts in $15,000 for that scholarship. We put in $25,000, and that young person comes back not owing any debt for a four-year college degree from JW. Pretty special. And we also encourage other aspects of growth as they graduate and look into the industry. So they're with what we're doing in that area. But we must do more, and we must make sure that more young people enter into the hospitality and the tourism industry I probably said enough. I'll come back for Q&A. And I brought enough people that can probably answer all your questions. We're going to ask Alicia to come and do, I think we have a couple different things on accolades. And we have a very special hire if you're really going to enjoy that presentation. So I will see you in a couple minutes.
Thank you, Pastor. about DOT, but without going into specifically what our mission is. I think oftentimes we get called on to do many different tasks, but I wanted to share first that our mission is to attract and retain visitation to the King Islands, particularly doing so by implementing sustainable policies, initiatives, and in collaboration with all of you, our stakeholders. And again, for the benefit of our people, we sort of talked about the King Islands and why we show up to work each day is to actually ensure that we're benefiting everyone else and the multiplier effect of tourism. Roles and functions. We do a lot of things. Today we're going to specifically look at what we're doing in the marketing promotions to support 2018. And just kind of highlight as well what we did in 2017. However, we're also responsible for product development, the regulated side of that as well. Public relations, image management, crisis management, and tourism. There's all these long things I've got to share that with you guys. Strategic framework and technical policy development, our MTP, would fall under that section. And then where we spend more of our time today on an ongoing basis is the research side of our work. The industry's changing so rapidly. The ministry would talk a little bit about the fact that there's a lot of data that goes into what DOT does. So we spent an enormous amount of time as well in research and information. Our partners, I was happy to hear the minister start to speak to talk about our partners, but we absolutely do not accomplish anything without you in this room. We work very closely with many of our partners here today, as well as people who are not here. And I just kind of wanted to match up to say that we're always talking to multiple individuals, and our work is only as easy as it is to be able to partner with you. So, how have we been doing in comparison to the world and our region? What was interesting for us when we pulled together information from the past 5 years is that 3 out of those 5 years, we were actually outperforming in terms of our pace, in terms of arrival against the rest of the region, as well as the world. So that's important to note because we see the benefit and we're saying that we're doing well, but we wanted to actually also show that the growth that we're having in our destination is something that we should be extremely proud about. And for 2017, what does that look like? Where did they come from? The U.S. remains our major source market at just over 89%, followed by Canada and the UK and Ireland. We did see a dip overall last year in the UK and Ireland, but that was as expected. The tumultuous times the market went through there. Continental Europe, we continue to see some decline there, stabilization so far in 2018. And then Latin America, we've had a concerted effort for the past 3 years and continue to see growth in that market. Not large numbers, but consistently strong growth that we're happy with. And then rest of the world, there were lots of other impacts going into that number. But we just thought we would share in a snapshot what it looks like. So the U.S., just wanted to kind of concentrate on what the numbers look like and where the visitors were coming from. Many of you may already know this, but we thought it was important to share. So we had over 340,000 people come from the U.S. last year. That's actually a 13.4% increase. The Northeast continues to be our strongest source market, so New York, Boston, Philadelphia. But we've seen strong growth in the Southeast market, and that's something that we've continued to watch over the past 2 years and feel that it's an area that we put a concerted effort into as well. We talk about flat and seasonality diversification. The West Coast continues to be what we call our real superstar. We have not traditionally had a lot of effort on the West Coast, but it's continuously grown. Over the past year, DOT has spent additional resources to support that market, and I'll talk a little bit more about that as we go on. So what are our priorities for 2018? Overarching priorities for us, so if we look at broad goals, not our marketing goals specifically, good governance is at the top of one of our priorities. We see as a competitive advantage to be a destination and department that acts as good governance so that you understand how we work and how to work with us. Implementing the National Tourism Plan, that's extremely important for the sustainability of our sector. We want to advance aviation, it's our lifeline. We know that none of our visitors get here and we're only as good as the lift that we have, so we'll continue to work on that. I talked a little bit about business intelligence reporting. It is critical high disposable incomes. Overall, there's intense airline competition. That's good news for us. It means that there's more availability and lower prices for visitors to get here. That has also been a benefit to us as we go and talk to airlines. They're more open to adding routes that are revenue rich. We're looking at one of those. As well as healthy corporate travel, this is something that we're seeing on the rebound at 0.6%. Large properties in the room will see this, I think, clearer so than others. And we'll talk a little bit about how we're going to support you with that. And then for the first time in a long time, we see that the demand for experiences have actually superseded the demand for goods. So for the first time, people are more interested in travel, eating out, versus buying the new car or brand new clothing. And that's important for us and encouraging as we go to market. However, we'd be remiss in saying that we have to mitigate the risk and plan for success. So overall, we saw last year was very vulnerable for travel globally. In the department, we work consistently to try to be ahead of what will be the next crisis. We do a lot of forward planning and how to respond, key messaging, and we work with you in our sector as well to manage through that. And then innovation continues to drive our sector. What are consumers doing? This is actually very important for us as we develop programming. Our consumers are tired of negative news, and that's globally so. Terrorism continues to be a concern, but not necessarily a deterrent for travel. And in unpredictable weather, we see all of our major source markets have gone through unpredictable weather over the past 18 months and continue to do so in some markets. In some cases, it's good for travel, in other cases, it's not so much, so we continue to watch how that impacts our bottom line. And then overall, there's a civil liberties fight going on in our largest source market, which impacts our messaging. And I put it there just to say that these are some of the things that we think about when we're facing message, when we decide who to partner with, and what we're seeing. Add all that together, and hyperconnectivity and social media, they're just tired. Lucky travelers are looking for ways to escape their realities and reprioritize what matters most to them, which is their personal time. So with that, what are the team's marketing priorities for 2018? We want to achieve our visitation targets. And I'm not necessarily going to share this, so I didn't want to share what our targets are. I'm happy to keep them internal. Secure and grow aviation. We want to leverage our trade relationships. We want to renew focus on group travel. We talked a little bit about the resurgence there, so we're going to actually help by focusing some of our budgets on that. Digital leadership is extremely important for us, and we want to be innovative with our promotions. On the visitation specifically, we're talking about addressing seasonality, and I'll share a little bit about how we're doing that. We want to increase our targeted segments. We've traditionally focused on family. Over recent years, we worked strongly in multi-generational and togethering. We want to grow repeat visitation and again talk about our Latin American strategy. So some of the tools we use internally, one of them is called Brand Heat. This is the tool we're just showing you this morning. And the goal here is to be in the top right category, protect and grow category. It means that your brand is healthy, people know about it, and you don't have to spend a lot of money to ensure that you're actually getting the visitation or your brand's up there as you like it. So important to us is that we are a luxury destination. And we positioned ourselves so, but it's helpful for us to always go back to, well, what is the consumer saying about us? So this tool helps us actually poll and research individuals in different categories. This category is those 200,000 plus. And what we wanted to show here was, guess the competitive set, how we came out with stacking up. So if you notice, we're in the right category of protect and grow for our 200,000 plus market, which is our affluent traveler. Our next category was what we call our base. This target, 100,000 opportunity for us. So one of the things that happened while we were busy ensuring that families and multi-generational travel was secure is that we lost some relatives with couples. Why that's important is because as we go down this journey of trying to address seasonality and grow incrementally, couples are extremely important. They have the flexibility to be able to do some things that families and multi-generation travelers don't necessarily have to do. So this is an area that data will be focusing a lot more on. We started last year, and we'll show you some of that later in the presentation. However, we want to continue to strengthen the families. We know the multiplier effect. We know how much the families impact the Caymanians overall, and we feel like it's a good fit. So we will continue to spend time supporting the family. It will be a scale back support, but it will continue to be a part of what we do. Mentioned that part of visitation, our part of visitation strategy is also repeat visitation. On the sailboat side, we're doing really well, but call your attention to on cruise, we actually had above 12% intention from 2016 to 2017, and that's very important to us. We know that we've got 1.7 million passengers in 2017 that came to see us. It's really important that they have experience and intention to return. This is a growth that over the past 2 years in cruise, and it's important to us again as we talk about increasing incremental visitation and being sustainable. And then our focus on American strategy again, we want to grow destination awareness amongst trade consumers specifically in that market. Our target areas are Argentina, Brazil, and Mexico for Latin American strategy. So there are many countries that make up Latin America, but these three are the targeted countries that we spend resources and time into support for Caymanians. I always get this question, why Mexico? So, if I would add a slide just to say, Mexico is one of those areas that tend to be overlooked by other Caribbean countries. We have a lot of competition in Argentina, Brazil, particularly with Barbados, St. Lucia, Trinidad. However, in Mexico, not so much. But the propensity for travel in Mexico is quite large. It is not a large spend proposition or time proposition for someone to get from Mexico to the Cayman Islands, as well as they're looking for luxury products. Just like ourselves here, when we're ready to go on vacation, you don't always want to see them. There are many individuals in Mexico that also have that propensity to travel. So it is a market that we added in 2017, and we're continuing to see good gains in that market. We also know that they're not in a rush to go to the U.S. So, aviation is also an area that we're working on, particularly we're growing West Coast access. So you'll see us spend a lot more time in the West Coast, and we're working specifically with partners to increase visitation there. Increased capacity in Air Canada. We've already had great growth this year in doing so. So Air Canada added capacity in both January and March, and what to come, so we're excited about that. And we'll continue to develop air access from Europe, specifically Rosal Complicants, the issue that roots Europe, working on airlift and access. So we know how important airlift is, but even more important, it helps diversify our seasonality goal. We talked about relationships, so specifically, we have a renewed trade engagement strategy. We're working to secure new destination partnerships, and some of those specifically for DIE. We have a renewed effort to work with our dive trade. We feel that it's a sector that continues to perform and we can spend some more time in. And then we're optimizing wholesale partnerships. Groups. Talked about resurgence of group business. So these incentives. Tom actually heads up our MICE strategy for the department. So he works specifically with properties in this space. And I would say that if you haven't already, please touch base with us on this. We actually have a concerted program of supporting you secure business. It's important for us to be able to share what your goals are specifically there so that we can tailor it to what you're doing. Sports tourism is also added back in 2018 in terms of our group strategy. Digital. We continue to want to be digital leaders in our space, not because it's initially what we're doing in 2018 is working on innovative promotions. We've got specific programs with influencers, creative redevelopment for each market. And the minister would have talked about how we're engaging to do things just slightly differently, and couples as an opportunity to spoke about earlier. So we spent a lot of time ensuring that we could re-enter the market with something that was exciting for couples and something that would be impactful to the destination. I think we wanted to share just right up. Share one of the promotions we actually launched last year. It's called the Weekender promotion. So again, back to couples, back to being innovative. We felt very strongly that we wanted to be able to encourage individuals to travel in the period that's generally slow. And Pirates have joined us on this initiative as the specific event for the promotion. So we're going to share our Weekender video. Executed romance advertising campaigns around
great job, Anisha. Thank you very much. Hope everybody enjoyed that. The one point I wanted to make with her presentation was the intelligence part of it. And we remember, Pilar, when we used to be presented, since Shamari got there, we would get presented by different magazines. And they would spend the morning telling you why you should advertise in them. So what we do now with the intelligence is we decide the magazines that we actually need, and we go look for them rather than them come to look for us. So that has been the shift in the way we do business now. So I hope this is informative. We're very happy to take questions. Very good. Thank you all very much.
Nice try. That's not going to happen. So I'll ask the minister and two of your senior officials to sit in those hot seats over there, the mics, and then we'll take some questions from the floor.